Centering on Peace on BCTV is supported by the Berks Peace Community and Wells Fargo Foundation.
Good evening. Excuse me. And welcome to Centering on Peace. I am Susan Shelly McGovern. I'm the host tonight. And my guest is Blair Seitz.
Hi, Susan.
A friend of mine who is also a member of the Berks Peace Community. But I asked Blair to come on tonight because as I've gotten to know him, I've become more and more interested in his story. And for those of you who don't know, Blair is a well-known photographer. His work has been published in leading magazines and newspapers in North America, Asia, and Europe. Some of the publications in which his pictures have appeared are Time and Newsweek, National Geographic, Traveler, Guardian, and New York Times Sunday Magazine. So Blair has also photographed 21 books chronicling his travels around the world, as well as his love for the countryside of Pennsylvania. He is a world traveler, he lived for 9 years in Kenya and the Philippines. And while he has this distinguished career, I invited him tonight to talk about how the traveling he did and the people he met along the way have changed him. So Blair will outline his story of how he moved from a small Mennonite community in northern York County to become a citizen of the world with a love and an appreciation for people of every sort. So welcome, Blair.
Thank you, Susan,
for being here.
Thank you.
And I am looking forward to hearing your story in more detail. This is a call-in show, so if anyone has questions for Blair or wants to comment, feel free to call us at 610-378-0426. Now, Blair, I'll just ask you to start by telling us a little bit about where you grew up, your family, and then sort of segue into how you got out of that sort of isolated community and into the world.
Thanks, Susan. I'll do that. I like to say at the outset, too, that this is not just for me. I think a lot of people have had similar experiences, and especially I want to encourage other people to have these experiences. But you're quite right that I started out in my life in a very isolated sort of environment. And I'm going to show you, in fact, where I grew up. Now, this might look like a picturesque place, but actually it's back in a dead-end road. And what you don't see behind the trees, somehow it's not coming up. What you don't see behind the trees are a lot of the chicken houses. So down here, on the right-hand side is dead-end road. There were two houses down the road from our house.
That's beautiful.
And then on the beyond that, there was a shack that someone had along the creek. I know because two boy and a girl, Patsy and Donald, got onto the bus. And when they got onto the bus, they obviously had not had a shower for a long time, and they did live in a shack along the creek. So yeah, this is beautiful, and the upside is that I could roam in the woods and I could ride my bike. The downside was that you don't see them all on here, but there were chicken houses, eight chicken houses and about 8,000 chickens. And every evening when I came home from work, even in the winter when it was dark, I had to go out and and feed these chickens, and also every chicken house had to be cleaned for new peeps every 3 or 4 weeks. So I shoveled a lot of chicken crap there too. But I'm going to show you my family also. And we were Mennonite. And at that time, we were part of the more conservative Mennonite church. Although this part of the church has mushroomed out and become more or less assimilated into the culture. But you can see that my mother had a prayer veiling, and she has the Mennonite cape. So that was the beginning. And in the church that I went to, it was a conservative Mennonite church. And the school that I went to was like, I went to four one-room schools. And the school was in Northern York County, rural school. And we had no African-American students. We had no Asian students at that time.
Was everyone Mennonite? Was it a Mennonite school?
Not until I went to high school, and then I went to a Mennonite high school, Lancaster Mennonite School in Lancaster. And I'll tell you a bit about that. First, let me show you this. This is something that anyone could do, and I recommend it. Down here is my very narrow beginning. And then these are up here, these are in the twisted top, are events in my life. Incidentally, I'm not an artist. And you can easily see that. But these are events which made my river a lot wider. It kept getting wider. There were some times that were rockies, and I'm 72 years old now, so this is like the delta of my life, if you please. So I'm not going to let that on very long because it's not a great art piece. But you can see, and anyone can do this, and I recommend it, draw your river and put the points on it where you have made specific widening of your river. Or sometimes your river might be shallow, sometimes mm-hmm. it might be deep.
Mm-hmm. That's nice. And as we had talked about that a little bit, and I said I was impressed with how intentionally you have looked back at your life and sort of taken stock of where it has gone and how those events affected your attitudes.
I recommend it for anyone.
Yeah.
It's a very good exercise. I found it in Richard Rohr's book.
Oh, okay.
Falling Upward is the name of the book by Richard Rohr, R-O-H-R. You ask about my high school. Well, I went to Lancaster Mennonite, and some of you here might know Lancaster Mennonite School now, and you know that it's like very assimilated in terms of the general culture. They have competitive sports, they have drama, they have a jazz band, they have a number of instrumental mm-hmm. groups.
But what was it like when you were there?
But when I was there, it was like the bishop's laboratory, because at that time, the bishops were trying to keep Mennonites non-conform to the world. In other words, you weren't supposed to be in the world. You were supposed to be separate from the world. Mm-hmm. And so at that time, the women had to wear black socks. I went there with a crew cut, but I had to let my hair grow out. I went there with white bucks. I had to get those things off. The principal stopped me on the sidewalk one day. So all that. And as I said, that's really changed. But it's... while I had some really good things there, for example, I was editor of the yearbook, and I was on student council and president of student council. I was able to do things that I might not have been able to do at my high school
right.
because I had to go home and work every evening,
right.
and it was quite far from the school. And my parents wouldn't let me go out for sports. So, but it was still a very narrow,
yeah.
a very narrow thing.
So and when did that start to change for you?
The big change in my life came in my junior year of college when...
And where was college?
At Eastern Mennonite.
Oh, okay.
I mean, when I graduated from Lancaster Mennonite, there were only a few of us who went on to college.
Mm-hmm.
Now, more did later, but and a number of my colleagues became lawyers and doctors. But I didn't go around like I took my I've taken my daughters around to look at
right.
University of Chicago, Maryland Institute of Art, and whatnot. There was only one choice, and that was Eastern Mennonite College. So I will say this, when I went there, I was already in a rebellious mood because, for example, when I was a freshman, I had a course called Religion of Sociology of Religion, which was
right.
a senior course, but I also read particularly this book called Honest to God, and it caused an incredible fervor at that time among church people, theologians, because Bishop A.T. Robinson questioned the virgin birth and a lot of other things. So I was reading that, and I was already questioning my guilt-driven, sinner-saved life that
gotcha.
I had come from.
So tell us what happened in your junior year at Eastern Mennonite.
So my junior year, I went abroad, and it happened like this. I was in a dorm room with other students and two African students who were there. And two of us, Henry Rosenberger and I, said, hey, you guys come here, so why don't we go there?
Where in Africa were they from?
You know, I'm not sure. I think at least one of them was from Kenya, and one may have been from Ghana.
Oh, so you did not go to their, necessarily to their countries?
No, I think we were thinking Africa in general at that time. We weren't that specific. But so two of us applied to University of East Africa and also to Nigerian University. Well, everything was in limbo, but until 2 weeks before school was supposed to start, and we got an acceptance. And I had friends in Nairobi who were helping. So I flew off to Nairobi. And what I wrote back to my mom was astonishing. I was just astonished by Nairobi. Nairobi is an incredibly beautiful city. The top right picture was a library at our university. It was a very multicultural city because not only Africans were living there, in a majority, of course, but also Asians from Pakistan and India, and Europeans. So I was seeing this mixed culture. I was also seeing mixed religions, like the picture at the bottom right is of a mosque.
Mm-hmm.
And then Kenya was also a newly independent country.
Okay.
So people were, well, President Kenyatta here, pictured here, was rallying up the country to pull together. The word was Harambe, which means let's pull together.
Mm-hmm.
So that was a, and flowers, you know, bougainvillea. I had to tell my mom about all this. And
Well, so that was certainly a culture change for you, a huge culture change.
Right.
And that, did that begin to open your eyes, do you think, to the fact that there was more than a Mennonite community in northern York County or Lancaster County?
Absolutely. I mean, when I was at LMH, it was like, I mean, mind you, it's not that way now. But when I was there, it was like Mennonites were the straight and narrow road, the straight and narrow. And like we were sort of the chosen ones, which of course in this setting started to feel ridiculous. I'm not sure if I really thought about it in that way, but I was so so positive about what I was seeing. It was so so new and so good.
Nice.
Yeah. I went to Hindu weddings with friends. I went to mosques. Over Christmas vacation, I traveled with my friend, African friend Asanga. We went into Uganda and into his home. And I was learning the African ways of life, mm-hmm. which were really different. Like one time we stopped to, the police stopped us. And I thought he was stopping us to tell us we needed like three less people in the car. But no, he was asking us if we would take one more person. If we could take his friend in the car. I mean, the driver was like sitting half out the door. But yet we sped. The drivers in Africa are pretty, African life is slower, but they don't drive slower, more slowly.
So how long were you there during this period in college?
I was there for a year.
Okay, mm-hmm. And then you came back.
Right.
And then, so just in the interest of time, like mm-hmm. tell us how you got started in your photography business and started traveling to different places in the world.
Right, I came back. It wasn't a soft landing, but I worked 2 years at a school for juvenile delinquents, which was an opening to me too. And then we went off to Africa again. We went off to Nairobi again, and this time wanting to become a professional photojournalist.
Okay.
In Richmond, Virginia, what I was doing up to that time was making portraits and doing wedding pictures. And I was practicing on my skills for magazine photography too, and in fact I had some pictures published in magazines at that time.
Mm-hmm.
And mind you, not in life,
yeah.
but I learned early on that it would be better to start from with, there are a lot of religious magazines, youth magazines that churches use. So. I had a lot of pictures published in those, but my first cover picture was on PTA magazine.
Oh, okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. So it's not easy to decide to move to a different continent in hopes of becoming a photojournalist. What gave you the confidence to do that?
I don't know. I think part of it was that I wasn't smart enough to know what I couldn't do.
Right.
And so I just did it.
Yeah, there's a beauty in that, you know? It.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I mean, a lot of people grow up with a lot of precautions. You know, you can't do this, you can't do that. Or there's a lot of fear built in. If anything, I like to say to persons who are viewing tonight is don't give in to your fears. Go out and do new things.
Mm-hmm.
Let me show you a couple more pictures from when I did go back to Africa as a photojournalist. Whoops, I'm sorry. So here's another photograph. And this, you can see I was really getting into the culture because my hairstyle was sort of like the Ethiopian guy, and even like Haile Selassie's.
Who's the gentleman?
This is Haile Selassie, oh, okay. The emperor of Ethiopia. When I was... Okay, let me show you another picture. This picture has a lot of culture in it. This is in Nairobi. It's in sort of in the back part of Nairobi, where you don't have the slick hotels and all that. So this is, the picture on the left is a hair salon, the door, and the guys waiting for the bus, reading the newspaper, the artwork. That's the kind of thing that was just all new to me, and I was just loving it, and it was great for journalism. This is a Somali boy the one on the right is a Somali boy at a Islamic school. And he's in the area of Kenya that's nomadic. Nomadic Somali people live. So, as I said, I was seeing and meeting different cultures. You see Muslim people and...
That's beautiful.
Muslims are like Mennonites or Catholics, or they have so many different groups, and it depends on your country. This is how the Somali women who were living in Kenya dressed. She was a shopkeeper. And I'll go on to the next picture. This is a Thai woman from Thailand, dressed in her traditional dress.
Oh, she's beautiful.
And I made a book that I called The Best of Asia. Here, Susan, is something that I learned that one might not consider. There's a lot about poverty. We read, we see pictures of poverty, we see a lot of refugees.
Sure.
But this woman is a refugee, but she's a Tutsi woman. And to me, she looks, even though she's a refugee, I made the picture in southern Uganda. She looks stately.
Very.
And,
very, yeah.
Okay, this mother and her baby, I didn't pose, they didn't know that I was going to make a picture. I was just, I think I had gone to visit someone, but I was just walking around. You can see in the background that these are like cardboard and metal shacks in Tondo in the Philippines, which is a huge slum where people come into the city and they want their children to be educated in the city schools. And so, they'll put up with this with this kind of living. There are no toilets. You have to get your water, at least when I was there, you had to get your water from, one time I was there, the buckets, there must have been 30, 40 buckets lined up at the water spigot. So I might want to go to another picture here yet. This is a favorite picture of mine, which is of a refugee, this time from Burundi, and I went to the country of Tanzania, just south of Kenya, I was working for the All Africa Conference of Churches. And you can see in spite of the situation, the conditions, the girl was working on a plank, a rough plank, and she was doing her schoolwork. What I found out recently from my sister-in-law is that these bags were made at Mennonite Central Committee here in Akron.
Really?
Yeah. They're made there, and they're sent all over the world. And I didn't know it then, but as it turns out, one of the bags ended up here in this refugee camp, or there were probably more than one bag, but she was definitely sure that this was a bag.
So let me ask you, Blair, when you were traveling and living in these different places and photographing people in various situations. Mm-hmm. Was it a comfortable thing? Were there times when you were uncomfortable? Like if you didn't feel that you could relate to people or maybe trust people, or was it not difficult?
Well, it was dangerous sometimes, yes. And people who read my book, this book that I made about my journeys over there, they say it seems like one dangerous situation after another. I didn't feel that way. Mm-hmm. I liked it. I loved it very much. Kenyans are, and Africans in general, are just really friendly people. Mm-hmm. And then there were all the advantages. For example, did I answer your question?
I think so, yeah. You felt welcome, usually.
I felt welcome. I had a purpose for being there. I was a journalist where there weren't mobs of journalists as there are here.
Yeah.
The difficult thing about coming back to the United States after you've been abroad, for me as a photojournalist, like even when the Pope was visiting the Philippines and I was covering, there were like 10 of us journalists. But here, if you go to a major event,
yeah,
you got a lot of journalists.
Oh, I'm sure.
And the one thing I didn't like to do was be where the rest of the journalists were. I wanted to stake out my own place. But here's one thing. I'll put this picture up. This is one thing that made it really wonderful for us. I asked a friend of mine, Karen Weber, to paint a picture from four different photographs that I gave her. I gave her one photograph with our VW Combi, and then I gave another photograph where these Maasai men, they were looking at themselves in the chrome in the front of the car. And then there were animals here. Usually animals were not quite that close to our van, but we were camping. And this is my partner at the time, Ruth Hoover, Seitz. So, I mean, this was what could be more wonderful.
But that's how you lived?
No, this is how we lived. This is how we went on week-long trips.
Okay. What were your accommodations like other than that? Where did you stay?
In reasonably nice houses, and I may be struggling with that because we lived in quite a number of different places, but basically they were, if it was an apartment, a rather small apartment, it still had a bathroom and
right.
and running water and all that.
Right.
So we didn't live like most of the people in the countryside lived. And in fact, when we went out in our Combi, we mostly took our own food with us so that we didn't have to worry about getting ill from
right.
local restaurants mm-hmm. and that. So that was, and we did use that Volkswagen bus one time to drive 10,500 miles from Nairobi to the Cape of Good Hope and back to Nairobi.
Wow.
Which was an incredible experience.
And so how long altogether? 9 years you were away?
10 if you count my year as a student. Yes. But we were 5 years in Kenya and then 4 years based in Manila. In both cases I traveled to other countries a lot to do the assignments. For example, in Africa, I did some work in West Africa and Ghana, and I did work in Malawi. When we made that long trip, we worked for UNICEF in Malawi and Tanzania and Botswana. And Well, at that time, you know, Rhodesia was still mm-hmm. an apartheid country, as was South Africa. Mm-hmm. I want to, maybe I'll show you that now. One of the most amazing things for me in terms of my life journey, in terms of having confidence in anything, was when I came back here to the U.S. And this picture is of President Clinton and Prime Minister de Klerk of South Africa mm-hmm, and Mandela.
Right. Oh, nice.
When they received the Philadelphia Medal of whatever, Peace Medal. And it was after, it was during the transition in South Africa. When I was in South Africa, I went to Soweto illegally. And it was at the time when students were, or after, soon after we were there, the students were demonstrating, and they were a large, very large number of them, more than 100 were shot. And that was, well, it was the beginning of the transition. But what Mandela was able to do there was something that I would never have dreamed of.
Hmm.
So that was a really high moment in my experience to come back here and see Mandela and de Klerk there.
Well, just let me ask you, Blair, so during this time that you were traveling, were you conscious of changes occurring? Did you and your partner then or other people talk about how you felt yourself becoming more embracing people more? Or is it something that you see more in hindsight?
I think we felt it then. And political views were evolving. My political views were evolving.
So what years are we talking about that you were away?
I was away from 72 to 82.
Oh, okay.
So a long time ago.
Yeah, but an interesting time. Yeah.
But the changes continue since I am back here in the United States. And I'll talk a bit about that if we have, I hope we'll have time. Could I take you to war?
Absolutely.
And what I learned about war? One assignment that I had was to go to the Sudan right after there was a peace agreement, after 17 years of war.
Hmm.
And this is what a church, for example, in the lower picture, looked like after 17 years of war. And the school in the top left picture, the schools had like 4-inch diameter trees growing up inside them where students used to sit.
Because
you can see that all the roof is. So this was rebuilding. Wow. We were there to cover rebuilding. But war is an incredibly awful, terrible thing. This picture on the left is from this southern Sudan also. You can see how they tacked together trucks to make them work. But when we were there, there was a very wonderful rebuilding going on. Only 5 years later, they started another 20-year war. These wars were between the North and the South. The North was Islamic. The South was either traditional Christians traditional religions or Christian. Now, the picture on the right is our rebels in the Philippines. I was in the Philippines during the Marcos years, mm-hmm. dictator Marcos,
mm-hmm.
and there were about 25,000 New People's Army in the mountains under with guns. Here's another picture of a couple of them. I I traveled with them for 10 days. It took me a year to get to the point where I was able to go there, working with people in Nairobi. Well, I went there as a reporter. I didn't go there to support them.
Right. That must have been incredibly, I've always been fascinated by journalists who go into war willingly, because it's something I don't think I could ever do, but it must take a toll. I mean, it seems like that would fundamentally change someone to see those things, to witness those things.
One thing that I learned as I learned to know more Muslims, more cultures, is that nothing is black and white, you know? We have to realize that everyone has, even rebels, have good purposes and good parts. So they're real people. So my going with the NPA wasn't like going to Syria or Iraq. And some journalist stories that I have read about, I wouldn't be there. I'm not into that. Mm-hmm. I'm not into that kind of warfare. Although while I was traveling with the NPA, there was a young woman killed, and this was a memorial. And what I said after this was, look at this, even rebels are crying over a lost comrade. This was the top left picture was a memorial for her. Mm-hmm. And these, a lot of the NPA were college students who just thought they had to go to the mountains and have an armed rebellion to mm-hmm. make changes in the Philippines. It's gone very much up and down since then, when Cory Aquino became president in the Philippines. A lot of the people in the mountains came down, but things have gone downhill. Although all along through, three or four presidents, they have tried to negotiate a settlement with the NPA.
So did you have your children while you were traveling, while you were away? They were with you?
Yeah, wow. Yes.
And how old were they?
Well, when we made that 10,500-mile trip to South Africa, Charmaine, my elder daughter, was three. And my sister went with us, so she had three parents. But, I mean, we were really fortunate because she was a wonderful traveler.
Wow.
And she didn't, yeah, she was wonderful.
Wow. and does she have memory of that?
We've gone back to Kenya so that some of the smells and things have come back to her.
Oh, nice.
We were back one time. And my younger daughter was born here, but 2 months after she was, 3 months after she was born, we went off to the Philippines. And she had her first 4 years in the Philippines.
Okay.
And they've become multicultural. I mm-hmm. mean, Charmaine has married a Palestinian, and she has worked out there, she's not now, for like 14 years as an editor and journalist mm-hmm. in Ramallah and Jerusalem. And Renee has married a man from the Dominican Republic that she met when she was in Peace Corps. I would like to, am I okay?
Yeah, you're fine. We're at 10 minutes out.
Okay.
So I want to start bringing you back to the States.
Two things yet. Let's see. I'll show you this picture. This is Laos. Now, this was Laos right after Vietnam fell, soon after Vietnam fell. Well, it was 5 years after Vietnam fell. And after Laos became communist. So I was there for the fifth anniversary. And then I went back another time but you can see the culture, and it was, you know, some people were reporting on this. They would report about these old men communists, but why not tell about the young women who were also part of the government?
Hmm.
You can paint different pictures. I also will say briefly this photograph, if it can be put up. This was a very big conversion and widening of my river. These photographs are from, all of them are from Jerusalem, I believe. But when I lived in Kenya, I think this movie's coming out on Entebbe, and I think there have been a couple movies, actually. But the Israelis came in through Kenya, and they did this heroic rescue of hostages that were being held in Uganda and Entebbe. Well, like a lot of other people, I was very proud of Israel's military prowess. But then my daughter is living in Palestine, and then I see the other side of the picture.
Oh, right.
Too, that Palestinians have, they have lost so much. They have, after 40 years of so-called negotiations, they still don't have a country. And this is a picture on the right-hand side is of the wall that keeps Palestinians from traveling, built to keep Palestinians out of Israel. The history there is incredible. The picture on the left is the upper left. The upper left, yes, is of the Church of Nativity, where the Orthodox Christians say that Christ was born. But look at the door, and I mean, yeah. That is, what is that, over 2,000 years old? I believe it was built then, or maybe later. At any rate, it's very old. Lower right, left is the Dome of the Rock, which is built on the Mount, I'm sorry, I'm losing my names. Well, I'll just say that the picture on the right then is a Wailing Wall, where Jews come. And above that is the Islamic holy places of the Dome of the Rock, and then there is also the Al-Aqsa Mosque. I hope I have time yet. May I? Susan?
Yep, we're about 7 minutes.
Here in Reading, we have a lot of opportunities to get out of our places and break out and learn new things. For example, the Islamic community in Shillington.
In Reading.
In Reading, yeah.
Yeah.
The Islamic community of Reading, right. Mm-hmm. They will soon be starting their Ramadan month. And every evening when they break fast, mm-hmm. which is at sundown, they invite anyone to come in and have dinner with them, mm-hmm. to eat with them.
I've actually done that numerous times, and it's...
Right. In fact, I know your church, the Emmanuel United Church of Christ, mm-hmm. does collaborative things.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, but I have found the Muslim community to be very welcoming and extremely generous. So I would join you in urging people to take advantage of that and get to know some people of different faiths and cultures.
There are 40 different groups of Mennonites, and then you have Amish. So that's another thing that anyone can explore, right,
right.
This area.
Right. So I think, Blair, we're going to have to start to wrap it up, and I like where you've taken us by bringing it back to Berks County. And I guess you've sort of come full circle. You're not too far from where you grew up. If you could just speak a little bit to the importance of being intentional, maybe, about getting to know others and not being afraid of other people, and you know, and what that does to a person who is willing to do that.
I recommend a couple things. One is read, for example. Karen Armstrong has written a lot about Islam and Christianity. Thich Nhat Hanh has written a book called Jesus and Buddha. There are many organizations here that you can become part of. For example, the Berks Intercultural Alliance. You can become a member of the World Affairs Council.
Oh, right.
And you can, if you're interested in Israel-Palestine, there are lots of Israel-Palestine organizations. You could relate to Doctors Without Borders. But if there are Jewish organizations as well as other organizations, there's an organization called Jewish Voice for Peace in the Middle East. And travel. If you travel, don't go to the luxury hotels. There are trips that you can take that are local. I mean, that will take you to
into
people's
the community.
Homes,
yeah.
Or that will be cultural. For example, these trips can be all over the world. But, for example, in Costa Rica, you can go on an ecological trip to Costa Rica. Our students now get to go to a lot different places than they did when I was a student. Even high school students go abroad. But don't go only to Europe. Like my daughter went to... when she was at American University, she did a summer in Guatemala.
Nice.
And these things really open the students' eyes to how other people in the world live.
They do.
It's breaking out.
They do. Well, I think we are just about to end the show. Oh, I just want to add one thing. Not only in writing, we have opportunity because we're pretty culturally diverse, mm-hmm. So we also have opportunities just within the city to meet many different kinds of people.
Yes, become a member or find ways of meeting Latino friends and also African Americans. Become a member of NAACP.
And don't be afraid to come over the bridge.
That's right.
If you happen to live in West Reading or Shillington like we do.
Well, NAACP has an annual dinner at the Hilton in Reading. Certainly people aren't afraid to come to the Hilton.
Well, we're just about to close, so I want to say thank you for coming on. Blair also is a host of this show 3 or 4 times a year. So it's good of you to take another evening to come on and be in the other chair.
Thanks. It's easier to be in this chair.
Is it?
Well, I always seem like I always have a difficult time with the introductions.
Oh, okay. All right. Well, good night, everyone, and have a good rest of March. We'll be back in April with more Centering on Peace. Good night.
Centering on Peace on BCTV is supported by the Berks Peace Community and Wells Fargo Foundation.